First, I want to start by thanking the elders for giving me this opportunity and Jeremiah. You apparently didn't feel the need to be here because you know I do such a good job, so I think that's why I was picked for this one, or the fact that a lot of our members are actually gone, so I'm not sure which is the reason for that. But I want to encourage comments. I have two chapters, but I guess I'm not like the other teachers, and I don't want to rush through this to get through it, I guess, so I encourage comments. I'll be happy about that. I'm going to follow the same pattern as the lesson kind of did and go through 25 a little quicker than 26. There's a little more meat in 26. And so let's get started. So from the previous chapter, 24, it's been 2 years. So that's how long Paul's been waiting in prison. Felix was removed and Festus took his place. So if I could please have someone read verses 1 through 5 in chapter Acts 25.
Now when Festus had come to the province, after 3 days he went up to Caesarea to Jerusalem. And the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul, and they petitioned him, asking a favor against him that he would summon him to Jerusalem, while they lay in ambush along the road to kill him. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea, and that he himself was going there shortly. Therefore, he said, let those who have authority among you go down with me and accuse this man to see if there is any fault in him.
Thank you. All right, so Festus, being the new governor of Judea, saw it necessary to meet with the Jewish leadership in Jerusalem. And there's also speculation that he probably saw it as an urgent matter, considering that Felix didn't leave the Jews too happy. He kind of left them upset, kind of just putting Paul to wait in prison because they wanted him to be charged and executed. So when he met with them, the Jews asked for a favor. They wanted Paul to take them to Jerusalem, and they would ambush and kill him. So they wanted to lie in wait and attack him to kill him. You know, so they've had 2 years to think about this. And they've had 2 years to kind of put this past them, to make it water under the bridge. Because Paul sat innocently in prison for those 2 years. So they've already done him pretty bad. I mean, to me, that, you know, sounds like torture. So, you know, he's already been punished enough for stuff he hadn't even done. But that wasn't even enough for them. Their hatred in this two-year period only grew. So they were really upset with him. And I think that this is kind of a lesson that all of us can kind of take. I don't think we have any killers in here, but I do believe that sometimes we can hold on to certain situations, whether we think we're right and they're wrong. I mean, this is 2 years, and it kind of sounds crazy that they're so upset over it, but how many times have we been upset with someone? Maybe they've even apologized, but we're still holding on to that 2 years later, still holding them accountable for that. So we can learn a lesson from this, I think, about kind of getting past certain issues and just letting things go. Okay, so then could I have someone read 6 through 12?
And when he had remained among them more than 10 days, he went down to Caesarea. And the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, he commanded Paul to be brought. When he had come, the Jews had come down from Jerusalem, stood about, and laid many serious complaints against Paul, which they could not prove, while he answered for himself, neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I offended anything at all. Say 12.
Yes.
Okay. But Festus, wanting to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and there be judged before me concerning these things? So Paul said, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews I have done no wrong, as you very well know. For if I am an offender or have committed anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying, but if there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me, no one can deliver me to them. I appeal to Caesar. Then Festus went, when he had conferred with the council, answered, you have appealed to Caesar? To Caesar you you shall go.
Thank you very much. All right, so Festus then went to Caesarea after staying with the Jews 8 days. Festus took his seat at tribunal, I think is how you would say it. Brought Paul in. The Jews presented their accusations. They had no proof of anything. Paul defends himself, saying, "Neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I committed any offense." Festus then asks if he wants to be taken to Jerusalem, trying to fulfill the wishes of Jews, because Festus was trying to help out the Jews in this situation. And he was willing to send Paul, who was an innocent man, on a death journey, rather than just letting him go, because he was scared of the repercussions that he would face. So Paul, realizing the motives, he exercised his rights as a Roman and asked to appeal before Caesar. And Paul also made it clear that he's not trying to avoid any punishment. He's willing to face the death sentence if necessary, if they find him at fault. But he knows that he's done nothing wrong here. In verse 11, he says, you know, he's willing to die if Caesar saw it be. This was the next best. He realized that this was the next best option for him, for the truth to prevail. And at the same time, it's interesting. Like, yeah, he could have skipped this. He could have went on. But he's been able to preach to so many people with all these trials he's went through. So it's kind of been so many people have heard the gospel. So many people have been able to listen through his preaching. Yes, Jason.
Another unique thing about Paul is the fact that he was born a Roman, and he has this avenue to go to Caesar and to be close to Caesar's household. And, you know, we see in the end of Philippians where he says that especially the people of the household of Caesar greet you. So he was making an impact in a lot of places that other people wouldn't have been able to get into. So that's God's will being carried out in that.
Exactly, that's a great point.
He's not feeling sorry for himself either. I mean, he takes every opportunity to preach, you know, to no matter who it is, where it is, and all that, and he does it, and he's more concerned with that than he is his own life, you know.
Yeah.
Good example.
Yeah, his confidence is, I mean, huge. It's definitely something that I need to be working on. I mean, his confidence that he does not care if he dies, he just wants the truth to prevail, is a huge statement and something that I think we all can learn from, because that is, you know, to me, people know that my first biggest fear is sharks, and my second biggest fear is being accused of a crime I did not commit. So this is just my worst nightmare. The fact that he is so calm and cool and collected, and, you know, willing to, you know, face the death sentence, and like he's not trying to get out of any punishment that could happen. I mean, he's going to the strict, you know, to Caesar, you know, so if he gets in trouble there, then it's a really big deal. So it's just really impressive to me how calm he is, how confident he is, because I would just be a wreck and so sad if this was the case and really feeling sorry for myself.
Testament version of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, where they're able to stand with the faith that God's going to protect them, with or without, you know, whether God has the power to protect them. Mm-hmm. And Paul here understands he has enough trust in God to put his life in God's hands. Whether he dies or not, it doesn't matter. My job is to handle the situation as I'm dealt it. Right? We are not required to convert hearts. We're required to teach the truth. And I think we kind of lose that sometimes because we want to go, well, I don't have any fruit because I haven't converted this person or that person or whatever. We're worried about the fruit. And it takes time for fruit to grow. You can't just plant a seed and a crop grow the next day. It takes time. It takes effort. And in fact, multiple people sometimes. Even Paul said, I've planted, Apollos watered, but God
mean, it is so hard, especially in this day and age. It's so easy to be distracted. And I think one of the hardest things for us as Christians is consistency and distraction. Because, I mean, there's so many things that aren't necessarily sins, but when put before God and His service can be. And we're just so busy all the time. We have so many things that we can distract ourselves with that it's easy to put that before God and make it all about yourself when really all it is just, you know, our life is to give God the glory and to spread His word. And so if we can do that like Paul, you know, that is just a huge encouragement to us and shows us that it is possible because we aren't being thrown in prison for speaking the truth as of now. And so, you know, we aren't facing the punishments that he did, and we're still, you know, I still find myself scared to speak out about certain things and to spread the truth. And he is just not scared at all. He is just, you know, spreading the truth, you know, not scared whose feelings he hurts, and it's very impressive. I think that's all I hand over here.
Yeah, Paul is certainly no stranger to danger because it seems like his whole ministry was staying one step ahead of death. Chased from out of one town to another one. He had to be let down by the baskets when he first started, and whatever people were trying to kill him. He's had people after him. He's been like a wanted man by the Jews, by the enemies of Christ. And so here he is in the Jerusalem, and now leaving.
I know it is. I mean, his story is just crazy to read. It is something that, you know, almost seems untrue that someone can have, to me, what seems like bad luck. But like what Jason said, we would see this as, you know, not great and negative, but it's just a way for God's word to spread. Yes.
I think of the scripture where Paul said, to live is Christ and to die is gain.
Exactly.
That's where he was. As long as he lived, he could preach Christ.
That's a great point.
He
was okay with that, exactly. And so that is very impressive and definitely an encouragement to me and something that I can learn from. Yes.
I know myself, I always think about the consequences. If I speak up, this is going to happen, this is going to happen. Might lose relationships if I really say how I feel or if I stand for the truth or whatever it is. Paul was missing that. Mm-hmm. He didn't care about the consequences. He cared about the consequences with God. And he cared about his responsibility to God. And I think if I try to shift my focus to responsibility instead of consequences, we can achieve that.
Oh, definitely. That's a great point.
Our influence on people is more apt to change and help other people based on what they see us do. Because how we live our lives has a greater impact a lot of times than what we say. Mm-hmm. And so people see you living like Paul was, like Jesus was, having Christ living in us. They're more apt to come to you than based on someone who's just talking all the time and then their life's not matching what's coming out of that.
Oh, exactly. I mean, there's no bigger turnoff to someone because to God's word than the hypocrites, because I think that a lot of time the world's given Christians a bad rep because there are hypocrites that claim to be Christians and things like that, but you know that it's they're letting the exceptions be, you know, the people who aren't great kind of run it for everyone, the people who really are trying to do what's right and who really are living by what they're preaching. And that is, to me, one of the best ways that you can, you know, teach someone God's word is just by living. And if you live it and they can see how, you know, happy you are to be a Christian and how even when it's hard to stand out in public and to be different, you still do it with a smile on your face because you know, just like Tim was saying, like, you're not focused on the consequences of it. You're just focusing on the results of it, or what it will do for God and how to make him proud, you know, that is just something great that we can all definitely work on. So in verse 12, Festus responds that he will take Paul to Caesar. He realizes that the Jews have no proof for the case, and it's evident that it is just a difference in what he says as like religion. He thinks that, you know, it's because Paul believes that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead and that the Jews do not. And so he's realizing that there's no proof. The Jews are just really mad at him. So it's pretty petty. And so King Agrippa and Bernice roll up and greet Festus. And so what is something that we know about King Agrippa and Bernice? Yeah, so that's pretty gross. I mean, I don't want to talk about that too much, but that is just very nasty. And so, I wish I wouldn't have known that, because that's really gross. But that was pointed out in the lesson, so I felt that I should. You know, so Festus explains to King Agrippa what's going on. The Jews have no case against Paul, and he's having a hard time, you know, writing. He's going to have to write something to Caesar. And so he doesn't have anything to say to it because he realizes that there is truly no case and that it's not going to be worth Caesar's time. And so that kind of leads us into Chapter 26, because King Agrippa then agrees to hear Paul's case, and Festus is happy because he knows that then he hopefully will have something to write to Caesar. Any last comments or questions on chapter 25? All right. I was really behind on him. Okay. So, chapter 26, it is Paul's defense against Agrippa. So could I have someone read in chapter 26, verses 1 through 11?
And Agrippa said to Paul, "You are permitted to speak for yourself." So Paul stretched out his hand and answered for himself, "I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because today I shall answer for myself before you concerning all the things of which I am accused by the Jews, especially because you are expert in all customs and questions which have to do with Jews. Therefore I beg you to hear me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, which was spent from the beginning among my own nation at Jerusalem, all the Jews know. They knew me from the first. If they were willing to testify that according to the strictest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. And now I stand and am a judge for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers. To this promise our 12 tribes, earnestly serving God night and day, hope to attain. For this hope's sake, King Agrippa, I'm accused by the Jews. Why should it be, though, incredible by you that God raises the dead? Indeed, I myself thought it I must do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazarene. This I also did in Jerusalem, and many of the saints I shut up in prison. Having received authority from the chief priest, when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme, and being exceedingly enraged against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities."
Thank you. So Paul begins his defense against King Agrippa. He lets him know that he's thankful to be in front of him today, especially because he knows so much about the customs and controversies of the Jews. So again, we see Paul finding common ground with who he's speaking with, you know, thanking them. He's not flattering them with words. He truly means it, because this man does know the custom and controversies. But even with a man who is in relationships with his sister, he is still able to find something to thank him for. Because, you know, no one wants to be put down when they're being taught the word. And I think that this is a good example of when you start out talking with someone, you don't, you know, start putting them down. You know, you try to let them find that common ground between them. And Paul's a really good example for that. Because even, I guess, some looked at him as a kind of authority in the matters respecting the Jews' religion. So Paul then goes into how he was raised as a Jew in the highest sect. He was a Pharisee. Now he's on trial because he has hope and a promise that God made, the same God that the Jews worship. And he's letting them know that he didn't defile his heritage. Their ancestors spoke of a Savior who would be raised from the dead. So why is it so crazy that he's believing that God can raise someone from the dead? You know, this is really what it is that putting that divide between, you know, Paul and the Jews is that, you know, he believes that Jesus was raised from the dead. And so that's kind of the basis of all the problems. And you can see he's kind of laying it out that he's confused. Why, if we both believe in the same God, but why is it so crazy? You know, if we believe God is so great and he can do all these things, what's so crazy about him raising someone from the dead? Obviously, he would be able to do that if he wanted to. And so he lets them know that that point alone is putting him on trial. And it's ironic that the Jews are accusing Paul of a great wickedness, of blaspheming, because of his devotion to a hope that their nation had cherished, you know, for centuries. But he acknowledged, too, that he also used to think that it was crazy. He persecuted Christians. He killed them. He went out of his way to find them and to punish them. So he was making it his life's effort to, you know, hurt Christians, you know. So what he's believing now is what he used to just think was crazy, and he used to essentially kill people over it. He is now about to tell kind of what led him to believe in Jesus. And, you know, the audience had to be wondering how he could have made such a drastic change. Like, what could have sparked this after someone who was treating Christians so harshly? How could he make such a drastic change and then start believing in the same Jesus?
I was going to say, it's very interesting to point out to me that this is an approach of reason and logic. He's not trying to just use some, oh, well, you know, I feel like this or I feel like that. He's using reason to defend himself. He says, verse 5, they knew me from the first, right? There's some history here. They know what I was about. They know what I did. But then, verse 9, indeed, I myself thought I must do these many things contrary, right? He's using reason and logic to establish this scenario so that they can understand this transition. And he seeks to explain further. But he's trying to build that groundwork. Look, I'm not making an irrational decision, which is what a lot of people claim religion in general is. It's an irrational placement of faith. But this is very rational, very tangible, very real. And I like that about his defense.
Oh, definitely. He lays it out. He thinks it through, and that's what I've been so impressed, you know, reading this, is just how smart he is. He is so smart, and it's just been really impressive the way that he can, you know, speak. I mean, he's talking before very powerful people. I mean, it talked about, I think it was at the end of verse 25, how, you know, King Agrippa and Bernice come in with, you know, great pomp and, you know, a lot of, chocolate and stuff like that. And so that would be intimidating to me. And he has been sitting in prison. He's been beat down, you know, for 2 years, and he still comes out guns blazing. He knows what he's going to say. His faith has not wavered. Yeah.
Yeah. And to his point, you know, in the next page, when he calls him, you're beside yourself, you're crazy. You know, he says, I speak the words of truth and reason, which I think is what he's referring to. And the point that, like, when he said, I'm judged for the hope of the promises made by God to our Father. You know, like, that's what y'all are trying to say, but this is the promises that were made. You should know these.
Yeah.
And these promises are being fulfilled. And that's what I'm trying to tell you, you know, for this hope's sake. And then that's when he goes, why should it be incredible by you that God raises the dead? And it's not just truth and reason that they don't know about. You know, they should have known these things. They've read them, and they came to be. And like he said,
it's not like he just changed. He went to the, he's doing, how do I say this? He is, what, who he is persecuting is who he's become, mm-hmm. I guess. Is, mm-hmm. And that, that should spark interest, you know, and he's explaining that. What's cool is when he's explaining why he's been in prison and stuff, he's preaching to them. Mm-hmm. You know, he's doing the exact same thing. He never stops that.
Exactly.
And it's repetitive, but, and we see two failed conversion accounts, you know, in these two chapters. And he keeps on going. You know.
Yes. Like DJ was saying, how frustrating would it be when what all these Jews have studied for years finally has come, and now they're not accepting it. You know, this is it, is what he's saying. This is it. You know, this is what
we've been preparing.
Yeah, and this yeah. is it. You know, yeah. accept it.
Definitely, that would be very frustrating, and kind of is, you know, just shocking that they, you know, can't see it. You know, it is almost just doesn't make sense. Like his, you know, like DJ and he was talking about is that is how he was handling this was logic. You know, when he was talking through it, but the way the Jews are just not understanding and the way that they are just refusing it is illogical. Like everything that he is saying, you know, makes sense. There's a reason for everything. He is going back to, it's been taught, you know, years before. This is what we've been looking forward to, and they still can't see that.
Not only he points out that they've all known him since his youth. Mm-hmm. All of these same Jews that are trying to persecute him and tell him he's and telling the magistrates that he's causing trouble and dissension. Paul is really not teaching anything different that has always been taught. He's just proven the scriptures and shown where he was wrong in doing the same things they're doing now. And but the benefit from it too is some an orator or a king like Agrippa come along. There's going to be, this is probably done in a huge setting with a lot of people around. And who knows what, because a lot of this goes away after a while. He appeals to Caesar being a Roman. A lot of this is going away. It wasn't too far long after Caesar was, I think he ended up getting killed, I don't know. But this Julian law for the Romans' protection went away. And there's going to be a huge persecution of Christians after that. Well, then you see the power of God really take hold because Christianity just grew even more. Mm-hmm. So, but Paul, this it could stem from this right here. Mm-hmm.
No, that's a good point.
I think Paul is also essentially preparing them because everything in the Jewish law has always been physical. Mm-hmm. Everything about it has been physical. The sacrifices, everything's been hands-on. Jesus comes and preaches a non-earthly kingdom, mm-hmm. and his kingdom is in heaven. And the transition that Paul is going to make through all his appeal and how he saw Jesus and spoke with him beyond the grave, mm-hmm. you know, and this is, like you were saying, they wanted something different, but it's right there in front of them, and they know it. But they just wanted the physical side so bad they just were they blinded themselves by it.
Exactly. And you know, we've probably dealt with situations like this before when either, you know, trying to speak with someone, you know, about the scripture and about God's word and you know, it's you know, you're not the one saying it. It's right there plain as day, but there's just this, you know, refusal to accept it and refusal to you know, accept that it's God's word and that they need to do it. There's just this restraint to do it. And then, you know, a lot of that has probably been built in them. You know, if they've been, you know, going to denominations before, you know, it's like, well, I've, you know, heard, you know, this is what I've been taught for years. Like, this can't be so. And it almost feels, you know, frustrating, but our life isn't at stake over it, you know, like it is with Paul. Like, he's been in prison and he's on trial. And, you know, how frustrating that would be and scary it would be.
I love the last two comments and this discussion. Because really, I mean, Paul's trying to get them to understand. If he can just get them to realize one thing that he realized that they didn't realize, and that is the resurrection of Jesus. That it had come to pass. That was the one
that's the only thing that separates them. And a lot of times it really is just one thing that can hold someone back from believing God's word or making that final step into baptism and, you know, repentance. It's just one thing that they, you know, cannot give up or accept. And then, you know, that one thing is in the end going to, you know, be eternal damnation. And that is just really sad. And it can be frustrating, you know, but again, we have to remember that, you know, it's God's word. And all we can do is be like Paul, spread God's word, not think about, you know, the consequences of what that might be, whether it's friendship, relationships, persecution from someone. You know, all it is about is spreading God's word, and the rest is up to them. The seed has been spread, and it could be years down the line that they could remember that and use that. Did I hear something, or was that noise coming back? So Paul is about to tell them why they too should believe and make that change. And he's about to talk about him on the road to Damascus and kind of how that started. So if someone could read verses 12 through 18 in chapter 26.
In this connection, I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests. At midday, O king, I saw on the way the light from heaven, brighter than the sun that shone around me, and those who journeyed with me. And when we had fallen to the ground, I heard the voice saying to me, in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. And I said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Arise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to anoint you as a servant and witness to the things which you have seen me, so those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles, to whom I am sending to you. I'm sending you.
All right, thank you. So Jesus appeared to Paul to make a minister of him and a witness. You know, he was commanded by Jesus to spread God's word and shed light. And now, if someone could read, well, I guess I can read. But I'm going to read two paragraphs from the book because I think it lays this point out great. It's on page 156. It's the second from the bottom paragraph. It says, Jesus appeared to Paul for the purpose of calling him to preach to the Gentiles. The preaching would produce a change that Paul describes in three phases. One, to open their eyes. Preaching enables the hearer to see what he has not seen. The listener can see clearly about God, Christ, salvation, and the church. Two, to turn them from darkness to light. Darkness stands for sin, ignorance, and error. Through preaching, the hearer is led to understanding and walk in the light. Three, to turn them from the power of Satan to God. Preaching turns men from the rule of Satan to the kingdom of God. You know, so we too have that command to spread God's word, and are we taking it as seriously as Paul is? Because I know I haven't been, and so we as Christians, we too are supposed to be spreading God's word and shedding that light. And I mean, he is going, taking it as seriously as he can. He is making it his whole life's work. Are we doing that? Are we taking it as seriously as Paul did, and, you know, not seeing the consequences of it?
He's also being taken way out of his comfort zone, if you think about it. Paul, he's talked about a few times, he was a Pharisee of the Pharisees, right? They abhorred the Gentiles. They could not go anywhere near them. They had all these rules. That was like the worst thing that you could possibly do, is go to the Gentiles. And here Christ is saying, that's where you go. And for him to lead that charge versus maybe Peter – but he wasn't a Pharisee, right? This is a Pharisee going to the Gentiles. That's just striking to me. God can sometimes take us out of our comfort zone and put us in situations that we don't really understand, but if we do our job by teaching the word and just being active about our faith in every situation, then he's using us for that situation and opportunity to reach someone that may not have been reached in other ways. And we have to be mindful.
No, that's a great point.
Yep. It's easy to read, and I get myself caught up in it, to read stories like this and think, well, yeah, I mean, God appeared to him. Mm-hmm. You know, of course he's going to do this. It's God's providence anyway. But then you think of great men like Moses. You know, he saw the burning bush and all those miracles, and he still was making excuses trying to get out of this situation. You know, so Paul was, he was a special guy to just take it and go, yes, sir, what do I need to do?
He definitely was. It was very impressive how much he could take on what we would see as a burden, but he sees it as, you know, he counts it a blessing that he is going through these great trials. And so now the second paragraph I'm going to read, it's the last paragraph on page 156. It says, the change produced by the preaching brings two results. The forgiveness of sins, their sins are removed and remembered no more. Two, an inheritance. Once one becomes a child of God, he is thus an heir of God. And so, you know, this is a reference to, you know, what we've been reading is a reference to baptism, with parallel passages like Acts 2:38, it's repent and be baptized. Acts 3:19, repent and be converted. And here in Acts 26, we haven't read that part yet, but Acts 26:20, it's repent and turn to God. So repentance involves a change in life. So Paul calls them to repent and turn to God. Paul then goes to explain how he isn't being disobedient to the heavenly vision, because that's kind of what they're trying to say, is that he's went into temples, he's done all these horrible things, he's blasphemed God, and he's letting them know that he isn't doing that. He is just doing, you know, the commandment from God and from Jesus. You know, and he also brings out, you know, the Jews and Agrippa believed in the prophets and Moses, so now he is showing how this was prophesied by them. That Christ, you know, must suffer and first rise from the dead to proclaim light to our people, the Jews, and then the Gentiles in verse 23. You know, and so apparently this brings out a lot of frustration in Festus, and he kind of interrupts and tells Paul that he is going out of his mind. Paul responds with still having respect for Festus. You know, he doesn't lash back out at him. He still has respect for them, and then he asks Agrippa, you know, if he believes. And so if someone could read verses 28 through 29 of chapter 26.
Then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. And Paul said, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether such as I am, except for these chains.
You know, so this is just really, you know, sad. So he even admitted that he was close to believing, but, you know, things of this earth obviously held him back. And so this is definitely something that we can learn from this. You know, how many times have we held back from doing what's right, whether it's helping Christians, spreading God's word? You know, sometimes we hold back from doing right because we are going to be singled out in a crowd. We're going to have to be, you know, different from others in an obvious way. And no matter what age you are, that's uncomfortable. I know there were things that in high school I had to do that was different than others, and it was, you know, frustrating, and it was hard, and it was embarrassing. But you learn, too, that growing up, that doesn't change. Things don't necessarily get easier. You just get stronger, and you study God's word, and you understand why you're doing it, and you have that faith behind you to do the hard things like that. You know, it's like standing out in a crowd. So if someone else could read verses 30 through 32.
When he had said these things, the king stood up as well as the governor and Bernice and those who sat with them. And when they had gone aside, they talked among themselves, saying, "This man is doing nothing deserving of death or chains." Then Agrippa said to Festus, "This man might have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar."
Thank you. All right. So they see that there is no fault in him, and they would have let him go, but he has already appealed to Caesar, so he still has to do that. So that is it. So thank you for your time.